Hey everyone, today we're going to begin our 12th lecture in our discussion about religion in America. And today, what we're going to be discussing is kind of a change in the American religious configuration, as I have here, a shifting religious configuration. And what I mean by that is, as more and more immigration has started to emerge, immigration from new areas that were traditionally less Protestant in nature or less Catholic in nature. And so, because of these new waves of immigration, we have introductions of new forms of religion to America in our political circumstance. So, we'll have with the emergence of Eastern European Jews for the first time to America in the 1880s and 1890s. We begin to have, instead of Reform Judaism and later Reconstructive Judaism, as we talked about, we have the beginnings of Orthodox Judaism arriving into America. And we'll talk very briefly about that. But the bigger part is the arrival of another form of Christianity that is equally as old, if not older, than the Roman Catholic Church, and that being the Eastern Orthodox Church of Christianity, and how it came to America, and how it was shaped, how it responded to the rise of Russian communism. And we'll also talk about, with the turn of the 20th century, we'll talk about the emergence of a new form of Protestantism, that being Pentecostalism or Pentecostal Church. And then we'll end our lecture today talking about the emergence of a new religious movement later on in American history, that of the Jehovah's Witness. And we'll also talk very briefly about some new religious movement groups that emerged within the African church or the African community. And we'll talk about that as well. So let's get started with our discussion about shifting religious configurations in the history of the United States in terms of religious history. So, really by 1914, so with the start of World War I, and America had experienced a end to the massive influence of immigration because World War II was starting. Many of the European countries were beginning to lock down their borders with the emergence of the German U-boats, or early forms of submarines and submarine tactics. Many, even commercial shipping were being targeted by these Russian U or German U-boats. And so, thus, many immigrants fall or were killed during the Atlantic travel. So, immigration was highly curbed at this time period because of World War I. But one of the significant consequences of all the early immigration from 1880s, really, I mean, 1870s as well, but it wasn't in a massive scale as it would later become the 1880s, 1890s, the early 1900s. Now, one of the main significant consequences of this for America was that it was a massive modification in the religious configuration in America. America had been dominated from its beginning by Protestantism, but as immigration kept going in the first waves in the 1830s, 1840s, 1850s of Irish immigrants and Germans from the southern regions of Germany, Bavaria, Bohemia, that are highly Catholic in nature, the Catholic Church became a new forefront. And then now, with the massive amount of Jews who were coming to America in the late 1880s, and Russian immigrants, Ukrainian immigrants, Greek immigrants, Bulgarian immigrants, Romanians, Serbians, Slovakians, all coming to America during this latter part, you have an introduction of a new form of religion in America, that being of the Eastern Orthodox Church. So the mounting Catholic immigration had significantly reduced the dominance of Protestantism or the Protestant Church in America. And we talked a great deal about this and that how the Protestant Church reacted, or how many typical Americans who, were Protestant or self-identified as Protestant, the fear of Catholic immigration equaled to this kind of basic arithmetic, this basic solution, that there was a fear of losing American identity, that American identity had been so much tied to the Protestant Church or Protestant ways of thinking, things like individuality, things like self-revelation or self-reliance upon knowledge, so knowledge of the Bible, reading the Bible for yourself, a disregard to tradition that is inherent within the Protestant Church. It also becomes inherent within the American identity. And so thus, with Catholicism that was very highly structuralized, very highly hierarchical, that had reliance on old ways of thinking at this time, there was a fear that United States would revert back to being similar to what the country was trying to escape from Europe. And so because of that, it caused a lot of internal disputes. And we've talked a lot about this already with the Catholic Church. But that same fears then becomes transposed as greater amounts of Jews start coming to America from the eastern regions of Europe, as well as Eastern Orthodox Christians, because of the consequence or the subsequent rise of communism in Eastern Europe as well. So these Jews who are coming from, Russia, coming from Ukraine, coming from Poland, regions that were once dominated by communist Russia, Jews automatically became associated in America with communism. And the same thing for Eastern Orthodox Christians, whether they were Greek, Bulgarian, Ukrainian, Russia, particularly the Russian Orthodox Christians who came to America, they were highly persecuted because of an automatic assumption that they are Russian, ergo, they are communists. So it led to a lot of divides. And so in the 2 decades prior to World War I, the Great War, as we've kind of already discussed, there was just these massive amounts of Eastern European Jews, around close to 3 million Eastern European Jews coming to America starting in the 1890s. And then you had new waves around from 1880 to 19, really 1920. You had about close to 18 to 20 million Eastern European Christians coming to America as well. So you had these new groups, so thus new fears emerge. But at the same time of these new waves of immigrations bringing about new religious configuration, the Protestant Church was also going through a period of turmoil itself. At the same time, there emerged a new classification or new category that religious scholars or American historians have deemed. And this is this term that we called disaffected Protestants. Now, if you're not sure what disaffected means, basically it's not something to deal with illnesses or diseases, but rather it is basically the phrase disaffected means that you're not interested, you don't care anymore. And so what emerges was a group of Protestants who really didn't care about their traditions. They looked at their traditions in which they grew up, which that they were raised at, and they were highly dissatisfied with what they had saw. And so thus it led to many Protestants looking for new things, looking for new for religious forms, new religious ideologies and thinking, because they were highly dissatisfied within the tradition in which they grew up, that the Protestant Church, in one sense, was becoming very stagnant and thus very rule-oriented. And so many people began to leave the Protestant Church and be either converting to Catholicism, converting to new forms of religion, like Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam during this period, very small scales, or people who were just becoming irreligious altogether, but they still would self-identify as Protestants, but would never go to church or attend a church. But still, they're a very small group. But we call them disaffected Protestants. And one reason that why this is so important is because we begin to start seeing really from the 1880s onward that new religious movements that emerge in America emerge out of and from this group of Protestants who become dissatisfied with the status quo, wanting something different, wanting something new. And so new religious movements were able to occur because of that. And so that's why we'll talk about them. So again, I've kind of already said disaffected really associate that with dissatisfied people, either dissatisfied people with authority or have no support for it. But in terms of religious context, people who are dissatisfied from the particular religious tradition in which they emerge. So very briefly, it's important for us to talk about a little bit of a survey of Eastern Orthodox Christianity. Typically, most, if not all, Americans really are clueless when it comes to the Eastern Orthodox Church. The Eastern Orthodox Church has a very small footprint here in the United States, about a population of 7 to 8 million Americans self-identify or have allegiance to the Eastern forms of Christianity. So therefore, it's very, very small. Basically, the state of Alabama in terms of context to the entire United States. So again, most Americans have no knowledge or idea or clue what the Eastern Orthodox Church is or its history. And so thus, we're going to kind of give a little small but brief survey of what the Eastern Orthodox Church is and what Eastern Orthodox Christianity is. So the Eastern Orthodox Church operates and is organized quite differently from the Protestant Church and the Catholic Church. It is hierarchical in some sense in that the Eastern Orthodox Church has bishops, has a priesthood similar to the Catholic Church or similar to the Anglican Church. But there is no pope-like figure. There is no pope that sits in a Vatican-like city among the Eastern Orthodox community. Rather, that there is a what they would refer to as a college or a collection of bishops that all meet together and that they operate and pass rulings and pass judgments on the whole of the church. So very similar to the Anglican Church or the Methodist Church within Protestantism. But however, that the Eastern Orthodox Church is organized even different in that there's no centrality that the Methodist Church or the Anglican Church might have, and that the Eastern Orthodox Church is made up of a lot of smaller nationalities and state-run churches. So you have the Greek Orthodox Church, you have the Russian Orthodox Church, the Serbian, the Bulgarian, the Ukrainian, the Armenian, the list goes on and on of all the various forms of churches that are typically associated with a particular nationality or ethnicity. And so they support a lot of differences and they encourage a lot of differences. So that's why they're organized quite differently. As I say here, the Eastern Orthodox Church typically encourages and promotes localization and nationalization of their churches. So thus, if you, for example, go to the local Orthodox Church here in Panama City or in Tallahassee, or in Pensacola, they typically self-identify as Greek Orthodox, and so thus practice much of the liturgy or much of their liturgical traditions come from the nationality, the language, the history of the Greek people. Versus if you were to say to go to New York or Miami, for example, where there is a significant portion of Russians, you'll have a Russian Orthodox Church, which again, its liturgy, its liturgical traditions are based from the Russian people. So again, the liturgy is sometimes not here in America, but occasionally here in America, the liturgy is conducted in a foreign language, but a foreign language associated to a specific nationality. And that the Bible is written in the vernacular language of, again, that ethnic group that self-identifies with the church. So you'll have Armenian scriptures, you'll have Bulgarian scriptures, you'll have Slavic scriptures, and there's some differences because of those languages and translations. And so the church, instead of standardizing, forced, like the Catholic Church, forced standardization of everybody using the Latin Vulgate, or in the Anglican Church, using the authorized version of the English translation of the Bible, that the Greek Orthodox Church celebrates differences and celebrates traditions. But there are some significant differences between Protestantism, Catholicism, and the Orthodox Church. And here are some of their significance. First, their religious practices. So, for example, the Eucharist that is being practiced in an Eastern Orthodox Church is significantly quite different, or even just church services, but more specifically the Eucharist, that meaning communion, or Lord's Supper, as Protestants refer to. So I have a picture here on the side over here of a Serbian church in Ohio that the priest is conducting the Eucharist. And you can see in front of most churches in the Eastern tradition, there is this great divider. And sometimes there's a gate here, but the gate is open because it's during Eucharist. And so there's this belief within the Orthodox Church is that because there is this divide during the practice of the Eucharist, this is when Christ or God physically manifests himself within the act of the communion. And so thus there is this holy divider, and thus only the priest or the bishop goes into behind the scenes or behind the screen here to receive the blessings and to perform the blessings that are associated with the Eucharist before he comes out. And so that is quite different. That is significantly different from a Protestant church where it's very open, where it's very communicative. The Catholic Church was similar to this, but didn't have the divide. But the priest would never face the audience at all. He would always face the altar, perform everything with the altar. And then even too, within most Catholic churches back in the day, you as an individual didn't partake of the same bread and wine that the priest partook and that blessed over, because you weren't holy as he had been sanctified and whole been canonized in a sense to partake of the Eucharist on your behalf. So again, it's very much different, but you can also see even the way the church is designed. The design of the church is significantly different. Also too, concerning religious practices, most Orthodox churches that you would go to, that the congregants never sit down. They always remain standing. Typically, that once you arrive to a Orthodox service, you immediately start singing traditional prayers until everybody arrives. So if you're an early arriver and you arrive 30 minutes prior to the start of service per se, would have to sing for 30 minutes straight, if not 45 minutes, because we know from past not everybody shows up on time and the show never starts on time. So some smaller differences. Again, we're Protestants or Catholics, there are pews, there is kneeling, there is stuff like that. Within the Orthodox Church, typically everyone stands. No one ever sits. You'll kneel at certain points, but everyone stands. And then also too, women during the church services are required to wear head coverings within the Orthodox Church as well, if they're stepping inside the church or most importantly during a church service. So there's some small differences. Another key difference, and a big difference that Catholics and Protestants really poke at and have always pointed to as a significant difference between them and the Orthodox Church, and that is the use of icons. So these are religious works of art or images. So you can see here, here's a wood carving that has been gilded with a particular image that is used for the Russian Church. So here's an image of the Trinity partaking of the Lord's Supper. And so these religious artwork, these religious paintings, these religious signs and symbols, so they would be everywhere. This is one that would be used at a person's house or hanging on somebody's wall. You know, in the apse here, you'll see that there is a image of Jesus here as well. This is a religious icon, as well as some other icons of famous biblical heroes. There's other icons here of prophets or saints within the Orthodox Church. So images are play a significant role. And it's the belief that because of these images, and because these images are used as ways to help facilitate meditation or help facilitate prayer, that these objects, because of how they're designed, are also infused with elements of divine grace. And so thus, because they help you focus and help you give attention, by helping you give attention, they also transmit elements of grace to you as well. So it's very similar to that of, say, you know, within Catholicism, the crucifix, or praying before these holy relics, with that are also within Catholicism. But these are more practical. But however, for example, the Protestant Church typically are condemn Orthodox communities by saying icons are equivalent to idols, which that would be against the commandments, the Ten Commandments in Exodus, that thou shalt not make unto thee any graven images or any idols. So many Protestants accuse Eastern Orthodox Christians of committing idolatry because, again, if you go to an Orthodox church, and I encourage you to, if you're curious, that they'll, you know, the priest or his deacons, assistants, will parade many of these religious icons around the service, and you would either, you know, say a prayer towards it or touch it, so it looks like they're worshiping an idol, but they're not. I've kind of already hit this already, but there's differences in leadership. There is no pope. But the Eastern Orthodox Church does have patriarchs that are kind of overseers, kind of like archbishops over particular regions and dioceses. Diocese is basically a Latin word meaning regions of controlled regions. And so they're called patriarchs. And so here's an image of Patriarch Bartholomew, who's kind of like the Pope in some senses, but he's not. But he is the head of the Greek Orthodox Church. But as the Greek Orthodox Church refers to all of their patriarchs, they consider them primus inter pares, which is Latin for first among equals. So that no single patriarch has authority over another, but collectively they all rule the church over their regions. But they do have a de facto leader, even though the Orthodox Church says they don't, they do. Because again, Patriarch Bartholomew has been the patriarch for the Greek Orthodox Church for a very long time, and he's always the one that goes and meets the Pope. So if you're meeting the Pope and representing the rest of the Orthodox community, in my mind, you're a de facto leader. But again, they want to emphasize that they have no pope, but technically they have some type of religious leader, where the buck stops. And also significantly, very significantly, there is a huge difference between an Eastern Orthodox Church and a Catholic Church, or Eastern Orthodox Church and a Protestant Church, And that is the architectural styles. Now, you might not see this here in Panama City, for example. The Orthodox Church here looks very much like a Protestant church. And the Catholic churches here as well look very much like a Protestant church. But however, if you go up to, say, New York City, or if you go to many of these larger urban areas within America, there are significant differences in styles and shapes. Typically, the Eastern Orthodox Church, on its architectural style, considering the outside of the building, they're very much dome shape, and they're looking because they like to. They have this belief in typical style that the symbol of the dome represents heaven. And so when you typically go with inside a Orthodox church and community, there is typically a dome-like structure at the top of the church on the outside, as well as inside the church itself. And usually that is where Christ, an image of Christ, is located in that dome. And thus, he's to symbolize that Christ is up in heaven, continually looking down upon the individuals. And so there's significant differences. And also, like this image here, there's huge differences. And you can see some of the styles. There's a lot of painting, a lot of artwork that represents something different than an Eastern, than a Catholic church or a Presbyterian church. So there are some significant differences. And so a lot of times, because of the dome shapes, the Eastern Orthodox Church often gets confused with Islamic mosque. But however, it is the Islam copied that image from the Eastern Orthodox Church, or during the Islamic conquest of, the Mediterranean area, that many of the local mosques that emerged were actually once Byzantine or Eastern Orthodox churches at one point in time, but then were confiscated and repurposed for being a Islamic mosque. So probably the most famous example is that in the city of Istanbul today, in the great building of the Hagia Sophia, which is Greek for House of Wisdom, it's a mosque now. With the conquest of Constantinople in the 1450s, it became and converted into a mosque. So it looks very different, but that was a church for so long. And so many of the Eastern Orthodox style of architecture was copied by later Muslims. And so the dome shape is actually something that came from the Eastern Orthodox Church. However, for the history of the church, the history of the Eastern Orthodox Church, everything changed with the conquest of Constantinople. So if you don't know your Roman history or world history, Constantinople became the center of the world shortly after the conversion of the Emperor Constantine to Christianity. He moved the Roman Empire from the ancient city of Rome to Constantinople, or modern-day Istanbul, there on the Bosphorus Peninsula there. That's between the East and West, or between Europe and Asia there. Constantinople became the city of the Christianized European world for a very long time. And the Eastern Orthodox Church ruled along with the emperor. And so the Eastern Orthodox Church was a state-supported religion by the Eastern Empire, or the Eastern Roman Empire, or the Byzantine Empire later on. And so this was the relationship that it had. But everything changed with the fall of Constantinople to the Ottoman Turks. And so the Orthodox Church had to change dramatically along with it. One of the key changes was that the conquering Ottoman Sultan Mehmed, he allowed the Orthodox Church, after the fall of Constantinople, he allowed and support, financially supported and encouraged the Orthodox Church to continue. But he also significantly empowered the local Greek Orthodox Church, and even more specifically, empowered the Patriarch there of Constantinople, in making him a de facto kind of pope-like figure, and that the Sultan would only communicate with him. the Sultan would only, communicate with the Patriarch of Constantinople, and that his communications and his rulings would empower the Patriarch to make changes across all of Christianity. And so the Greek Orthodox Church became empowered by the Ottoman Turks and subsequently tried to Mehmed and fellow other sultans in Turkey wanted the Orthodox Church to take control and become a little more universal. And by empowering one of the nationality churches or one of the denominations, if you want to call it, of Greek or of Orthodoxy, by empowering the local Greek Orthodox Church, the Greek Orthodox Church is now the biggest because of that. Outside of the Russian Church, of course, but the Greek Orthodox Church has kind of absorbed all the other ones. So, for example, Bulgarian Orthodox communities, even though they're somewhat separate, they fall under the leadership and the head of the Greek Orthodox Church. The same is with Serbia, with Romanian, with Slavic countries as well, that they look towards the Greek Orthodox Church for authority. But the Russian Church didn't take kindly to that. And so because the Russian community, which was Orthodox from the year 800s, 900s going forward, that the Russian Orthodox Church saw that when Constantinople fell, that the mantle of power and leadership had passed to Russia. And so that's why the Russian kings and Russian emperors were always referred to as czars. Czars is the Russian word for Caesar. And so not only did Russia emperors saw themselves as the continuation of the old Roman Empire, and the Russian Orthodox Church saw itself as the continuation of the true form of the Greek Orthodox, or of, not Greek, but the true form of Orthodox Christianity. Russia, for a very long time, and really still to this day, refers to itself as the Third Rome. And so I don't have a slide, or I wanted to have a video clip of this, but I can't find a good translation with the video clip because of Vladimir Putin, and him primarily only speaking Russian when he does interviews. But there's a famous interview that Vladimir Putin did start right prior to the start of the Russian Russia conflict or Russian influence within the Syrian Civil War, that he's interviewing by a press, and the press asks him, why are Russian troops going to Syria? And one of the reasons that he gives, that Putin gives, is he talks about faith and religion. He says that the Russian church and the Russian state have the authority and the responsibility to protect all Orthodox Christians. And so Syria has a significant, minor but significant, population of Syrian Orthodox Christians, or in the Syrian Orthodox Christian Church. And so Vladimir Putin sees himself as rescuing and protecting and bringing into the fold the Syrian Orthodox Church into the Russian Orthodox Church and influences. So he talks about himself as being, the savior of Orthodox Christianity. And the Russian Church also, later on in the interview, talks about that there is their responsibility to protect other Christians and bring them into the fold as well. So there becomes now this huge divide within the Orthodox community of the Greek Orthodox Church and the Russian Orthodox Church and their communities. Oh, this didn't go right. So there we go. But however, so let's talk about a survey of the Orthodox Church in America. And so the first Orthodox Christian community in Corrigan, in his textbook, he talks about the first community actually being in Alaska. He's wrong. The first Orthodox Christian community to arrive in the New World, for a short period of time, were in fact Greek Christians, not Russian Christians, but a group of Greek Christians, about 1,400 of them, were trying to flee persecution from the Ottoman Empire. And so they arrived in the New World in April of 1768, and they established a Greek colony in what is known at that time as British East Florida. And so they established a new community, a new colony, just near the Dayton, Florida area, there on the East Coast, called New Smyrna. And the city of New Smyrna still exists today, but it's attributed to, it's attributed to this community of Greek Orthodox communities who came to America. But however, the community didn't last too long because the Greek Orthodox community was forced to disband their colony, primarily due to native Indian raids, but also when the start of the Revolutionary War, Britain began to lose control over East Florida. And so Florida subsequently became, particularly East Florida, subsequently became a territory of Spain again. A colony of Spain again. And so Spanish were very much Catholic, wanted everybody to be Catholic within their communities. And so the Spanish church as well greatly persecuted the Greek community that was here. And so they disbanded their community, and mainly due to native attacks that they fled to St. Augustine. But later, once they arrived in St. Augustine, the Spanish took over. Many of the Greek Christians that were there were forced in to convert to Catholicism in order to survive. So the Greek community there didn't succeed, but they were the first here in Florida. But the first permanent establishment did occur in Alaska when Russian merchants, as the Russian Empire was greatly expanding, this was Russia's attempt to create a colony and get in on the action that Great Britain and France and Spain and the Netherlands were all enjoying. And so the Russians wanted to get on the action too, and so they colonized large portions of Alaska in 1784. Initially, the Russian colonists, when they came to America, were met with a lot of native resistance, and many of the merchants started to appeal to the Russian royal court for aid. And so the royal court did respond, but they also respond by teaming up with the Russian church. And the Russian church agreed to send missionaries to go and evangelize the natives there. And so it was the belief that if the native Indians there in Alaska became Christianized, that they wouldn't stop attacking fellow Christians. And it actually worked. The Russian church made significant inroads within a lot of Alaskan native communities. Some of the Eskimo native communities, Alouettes and the Tlingits people, were converted to Russian Orthodoxy. And much of their effort was due to particularly one man, Ivan Venizonovan, who would later become the first American in a way. Because he was born here in Alaska, but he became the first American saint of the Orthodox Church, and who he established several churches within Alaska, some that are still in existence today by native communities. And he was also fundamental in actually recording and creating for the Alouette people a writing system for them, and that he created the Alouette alphabet and writing system. And he was also a kind of geologist, or geographer is the better word, amateur geographer. And he created one of the first naturalist reports for Alaska as well, talking about the fauna, the flora, the animals, the geography of the territory. And much of Ivan's reports made its way to William Seward, who was the Secretary of State under the Lincoln administration. It was Seward who famously bought Alaska from the Russians, but he was influenced by much of Ivan's writings about Alaska and much of in the belief of gold. And Ivan talks about gold and natural resources in these territories, and he was right. But much of Ivan's writings was used by a lot of the early settlers of Alaska, in being able to navigate the territory. But however, although Alaska was bought by the United States again by William Seward, or sometimes the purchase of Alaska is known as Seward's Folly because everybody thought it was stupid that he bought Alaska, but it turns out later on he was right once they discovered gold in the territory and then later some natural resources in Alaska. And Seward proved to be, a genius for what he bought it for. But anyhow, even though the United States had bought Alaska from Russia, that prior to that, there was some Russian communities beginning to make headways into other areas of the United States, particularly the West Coast. And so we have shortly after the purchase of Alaska that Orthodox Church communities began to be established and emerge in San Francisco. And then later, due to Russian immigration, there was began to have Orthodox churches emerging in New York City starting in the 1870s. Eventually, the Russian Orthodox Church diocese, the headquarters for all over of North America, or particularly the United States, was relocated from Alaska to San Francisco in 1872. But then, as Russian Orthodox communities begin to emerge in more significant quantities on the East Coast versus the West Coast, the diocese was moved later to New York in 1905, and that's where it's still headquarters today for the Orthodox community in America. So let's keep continuing with our survey. So the majority of Orthodox Christians came to the United States in the 30 years prior to World War I, and they came to America really as results of much of the political and economic upheavals that was emerging in Russia in the 1880s, 1890s, and then later with significantly with the Russian Revolution in the 1917. As well as much of the problems that were emerging within the Balkans. And so the Balkans, if you're not familiar, refers to the modern-day territories in Eastern Southern Europe, being Greece, Macedonia, Bulgaria, Serbia, Montenegro, Romania, what else? Bosnia, Albania, that territory, that the land in between the Adriatic Sea and the Black Sea, on that in Europe. So that's referred to as the Balkans. And so during this time, there was a lot of countries that were fighting and revolting against the Ottoman Empire, who had control over much of the Balkans since the 1500s. And so there was a lot of civil wars, a lot of political upheaval in the Balkans, and then a lot of political and economic upheaval in Russia, as Russia was undergoing several civil wars and revolutions, and then, of course, the great one being the Russian Revolution that started communism. And so a lot of people were leaving and coming to America out of safety. And so thus we start seeing Serbians, Slavs, Greeks, Russians, Romanians, Ukrainians, Armenians starting to migrate to America in droves and creating little hot pockets of our little demographic areas where these communities would emerge. So, like in New York City, Jamaica Bay, there in Queens area, is a hotbed for a lot of Russian immigrants who came to America. Slavs. The greater Cleveland area in Ohio, it became a hotbed for a lot of Slavic people to emerge and come to America, Greeks. You have Chicago, later Detroit, became huge areas for Greek populations. Romania, western Pennsylvania, particularly Pittsburgh, but in the mountain regions, and Armenians came to mainly Miami, but then later in droves moved out towards LA. So you had certain pockets that came. And so they brought with them an extremely different culture to Western Europe, or that was different from Western Europe and the Americas. Mainly, the huge difference was style of clothing and, of course, style of language. That most Americans were familiar with people who were migrating from Western Europe, Germans, French, Italians, and they all kind of looked alike, sounded alike to some extent. Are dressed alike, and they were again either Protestant or Catholic. And now you have people that most average Americans weren't familiar with, and they're coming from these territories that speak a completely different language, have a completely different religious tradition. And so there tended to be a lot of anxiety between the two communities because again, there was clear differences, even down to the dress. There were significant, huge differences between these two communities. But however, the Orthodox community really didn't suffer that much and didn't suffer under the same fears that a lot of Eastern European Catholics suffered, like we already discussed in our last lecture. The Polish, the Lithuanians, the Eastern Germans as well, when they arrived to America. They did not have that same attitude of, as I have here, when you lose your language, you lose your church. They did not have that same attitude. And there are several reasons for this. Reason number one was that the Orthodox Church was still very autonomous, as we've already discussed. That's why it was so important for me to discuss about the nature of its makeup. It was very autonomous and allowed for localization to occur and encouraged adaptation. So the Orthodox communities that began to spring up here in America evolved to the dynamics or to the demographics of the needs of the communities. So particularly because they were very autonomous, they were given a lot of free range and control. And so you didn't have somebody like the Catholic Church. You didn't have communities back in, Poland or back in the Vatican that were upset that the Catholic Church there in Buffalo or Rochester per se was becoming more Americanized. You didn't have that fear. So the Orthodox churches started to evolve. They started to look a little more like Protestant churches. Some Orthodox communities began to adopt pews, which is controversial. Like I know here in Tallahassee, in the church here in Panama City, that it has pews. But if you go up to Chicago or New York, typically the Orthodox churches there don't. But some have adopted them very much so, or that they'll give their, again, some of the Orthodox churches in New York or Chicago, won't use English in their services, but the ones down here will use English all the time. So again, they're adopting and localizing their traditions. And there was no centralized authority, even though there was some kind of figurehead in New York. There was a lot of free range because the communities were so small and not well organized at this point. And number two, probably the biggest, is that many of these immigrants who are coming from Serbia, Slav, Greece, Romania, Albania, these territories, that at the time that they're migrating to America, they had no real sense of nationality. And what I mean by that, even though we identify them as Serbs, Slavs, Greeks, Romanians, Ukrainians, based off of their language, they were still a part of some other country. So, for example, the Ukrainians didn't have a country of their own per se. They were a part of Russia, or their territories were being fought over by the Polish-Lithuanian kingdoms. The Serbians and the Slavs and the Romanians, for really since the 1500s, were under the domination of the Ottoman Turks. And so Serbia really didn't exist, even in history, but the language and the people do. Slavia, was made up of the Hungarian kingdoms or the Austrian kingdoms, but they spoke a different language. And Romania was really didn't become a thing or a country until 1848. So again, it was very nationality and nationalism didn't really exist among these communities. And so because of that, when many of the Orthodox communities and migrants were coming to America, they were willing to band together, and they would be willing to attend other people's churches. So there was a lot of so for example here and no let me give when I lived in Raleigh, well, yeah, when I lived in Raleigh, North Carolina, there was a couple of there was two Greek Orthodox churches, but they were very small. But the biggest Orthodox church in Raleigh was the Ukrainian Orthodox Church. But yet you would go into the church and not a soul, well, probably about 10 to 15% of the population were ethnically or ancestrally Ukrainian. The rest were Greeks, the rest were Serbian, one or two Romanian families. And so they didn't go to their own, national community. They went to somebody else's because, again, they recognized that they needed to bond together. So that happened a lot of times, that either the Greek Orthodox churches became the dominant forms here in America, or the Russian Orthodox churches, and people would either go to each one of those. And they still kind of remain that way today. So they would band together because, again, there was no sense of nationality, but they still recognized each other's traditions. And so they didn't really have that fear of lose your language, lose your church. So they weren't, or the Armenian community said, I didn't, I got to establish my, communal church and I can't go to yours. There really wasn't that at the very beginning. Later on, there would be, but at the beginning, there wasn't. However, by 1917, the largest diocese in the United States of the Orthodox Church was, in fact, the Russian Church. It had started as early as 1817 here in America that there was only 10 Russian churches here, but by the time of 1920, there was over 350 churches that were identified as Russian Orthodox churches. But when the Russian Revolution occurred in 1917, it had greatly affected the whole of the Eastern Church on a global scale, more so even here in the United States. So if you're not familiar with the Russian Revolution of 1917, very quickly, in October of that year, the Russians were in the middle of World War I, and the Russian armies were losing dramatically to the Germans, and there was a lot of revolts, a lot of rebellions happening back in Russia because the war was turning badly. And so in October of 1917, a group of political activists and political party known as the Bolsheviks, who were a combination of communism and socialism and totalitarianism all wrapped into one, united with the Communist Party and united later with the Socialist Party into overthrowing the Tsarist government. So overthrow Tsar Nicholas II. And dissolving the Russian Empire and creating a new state, the communist Russia. And they also, because of this, they quickly declared a separation between the church and the state, because prior to the emergence of communism, as I said before, the Russian Orthodox Church and all Orthodox churches were significantly tied to the government, and they still are. But during this period, this is where it was a separation that the communism doesn't is advocates for atheism, sees the root problem in society as being the church and Christianity. So it declared a separation between the church and state, and subsequently went about seizing all church property and church land. So the October Revolution would later spur the Russian Civil War between Bolsheviks and nationalist parties, between the red and white armies, the white being the loyalists, the red being the communists. And so between 1917 and 1922, many of the Orthodox Church leaders supported the White Army, supported the loyalists to the monarchy, loyalists to the Russian Empire, which because of that, it served to strengthen the animus between the Bolsheviks and the church. And so during that period, you had over 1,200 Russian priests who were publicly executed, and countless other lay leaders that were publicly executed during this time. And so it forced the Orthodox Russian Church to go underground because of the severe levels of persecution that were occurring at this time. And so the communists and the Bolsheviks' policies in Russia, and then later as the communist movement spread to more and more parts of Eastern Europe, it forced thousands of Eastern Europeans to flee to the United States and Great Britain. So this became another second wave of Orthodox communities coming to America and becoming to Russia. However, back in the United States, the rise of communism back, that they saw the overthrow of Tsar Nicholas and the brutal murder of his entire family by the communists. Even his children were publicly shot to death several times. The story, yeah, it's a brutal story. I won't go into that, but it's a great tragedy of what happened to Tsar Nicholas and his family. But the Russian rise of communism caused a great fear and concern from really any person who was coming from Eastern Europe. We could talk about, and I could lecture about, Eastern Jews that were coming to America and the problems that they were facing. But since we're talking about the Orthodox Church, I'm gonna keep it within the Orthodox community. And so, what was known in the political history of America as the Red Scare, which basically meant this emergence of, with the emergence of communism, it promoted a widespread fear of anxiety and among average Americans, and the fear that similar uprisings and anarchism would emerge here in the United States or in Great Britain. So there was a great fear of anybody that was communist. So during the first Red Scare, there was actually two Red Scares, one prior to or after World War I and one right after World War II. And we all know the big Red Scare, the second one, because of McCarthyism in the 1950s. But there was a first wave happened in the 1920s, known as the first Red Scare. And it was perceived communist threats from Eastern Europeans led to massive amounts of persecution in the United States. And so, but some of it, as I say here, some of it was in fact warranted. A lot of it was just speculation, and so a lot of fear and anxiety, but it became warranted when in 1919, between April and June, federal agents discovered about 40 bomb plots that were to occur in the United States by many communist supporters and sympathizers who had migrated to America recently, and that there was 40 bomb plots as well as 36 assassination plots designed to attack political leaders and economic leaders. So, for example, J.P. Morgan, the famous J.P. Morgan, actually, two, who was the other one? George Bush. Not George W. Bush, but George H. Bush, his father, I cannot remember his name, something Bush, but his father was a wealthy businessman, but his father was also attacked as one of the people that was supposed to be assassinated, the president, as well as several chief justices were to be attacked as well. Some senators were supposed to be assassinated. And so between April and June of 1919, over 5,000 arrests were made. And out of that 5,000, almost all of them, I think about 90% of them were all people of Eastern Orthodox or Eastern European descent or Eastern European migrants that came to America. And so anybody who was Eastern European became attacked. And so there was a lot of riots, a lot of persecution. Many of the Eastern Orthodox communities, their churches were burned down to the ground during this time. And I have here, and many of them were just simply arrested and thrown in jail without due process and due cause. And this created some outcry among a lot of Americans because they were fearful that what's going on, that you're just arresting people, that federal agents actually in May in D.C. Went inside and broke up a Orthodox church service that was going on and started arresting people left and right. And it became people were scared and people started running. Some of the members started to fight back, and a lot of them were I think six of the congregants were literally beat to death by federal agents at this time. So but in D.C. and across America, there spurred a reaction that some people were saying this is not right, this is not fair. However, there's this op-ed that I wanted to preserve that was from the Washington Post that famously summarized most of Americans' beliefs at this time and those who had Eastern European descent. And it was talking about, how there was no due process for these people. They were just simply being arrested, thrown in prison, and some of them had never faced a judge for several months until finally enough lawsuits and they were forced to leave or release these people because there was no charge on them. But this Washington Post article quotes talking about there is no time to waste on hair splitting over the infringement of liberty on these lesser people. And so, like I said, during the first Red Scare, this was the attitude that many Eastern Europeans, and particularly the Eastern Orthodox Church, had to deal with here in America. They were seen as lesser people, that they did not have, that we need to, suspend habeas corpus. We need to suspend all our ideas of what free justice, what rights, what individuality, what due process of law looks like, because here's the enemy. The enemy's here, and it was, again, it was warranted because the many federal agents, and most of these federal agents, and the most famous one of them was Herbert Hoover, and Herbert Hoover would use this to go about creating the FBI. But Herbert Hoover was actually one of these agents during this time, and who uncovered the bomb plot against, I think it was Oliver Wendell Holmes, the Chief Justice, and that's how Herbert Hoover became famous. But again, this was the attitude that most Americans had. But in response to this, the Orthodox, many of the American Orthodox communities began to establish themselves and reorganize themselves here in America into national dioceses. And mainly the reason they did that was because it was an effort to distinguish themselves. It was their attempt to help distinguish themselves from communism. So really here in America is where we have this, and you don't have it anywhere else. You don't, well, you have it in the UK, but you don't have it in France. You don't have it in Germany. But you do have it in the UK, and you have it here in America, where we do have a lot of national dioceses. And the reason that we do have that is because of the first Great Red Scare. And so the Orthodox American communities all decided to meet, and they started to organize and establish themselves around, or these ethnicities and these identities. And so the Greek communities were very much anti, and the Greek country that eventually would emerge was very much anti communist, was very much pro-democracy, was very much pro-loyal to England. Serbian as well as Ukrainians were fighting over their idea of being separate from Russia. But it was an attempt, again, to say by the American Orthodox community, we're not them. So how they did that was they just started to identify their churches by nationalities. And so communist authorities saw this, and they attempted to use the Russian Orthodox churches in America as bases of espionage. And if any priest or any bishop that did not favor this process or tended to favor American ideas or sympathies were often deposed by the Communist Party, or they were forcibly blackmailed or set up. There's this one famous example of a bishop in Washington, D.C., that he refused to allow his church to be a base of operation for espionage. And so all of a sudden, mysteriously, he was arrested by the local Washington, D.C. police because all of a sudden he had massive amounts of debt all of a sudden and things being charged to him. And then later it was uncovered in court that it was the Russian government that had falsified records and falsified things and gave a false report in order to have the bishop arrested so that he could be removed and replaced by a bishop that was sympathetic to the Communist Party. So again, this is another reason why a lot of the American Orthodox communities had to make separations because the Russian community or the Russian Communist Party was using the Orthodox Church to their advantage at times. But however, in response to that, many Russian Orthodox dioceses included as well, but all of the Orthodox communities, they met again in April of 1924, and they took a historical step to declare the churches in North America, the Orthodox churches in North America, as temporarily self-governing, saying that they don't respond, that they don't associate themselves with anybody from Europe. That they associate themselves with the America and with Canada only, and that is it. And they said they would not communicate, would not cooperate with any European community, basically until communism was removed from the church as a whole. And so this was the attitude for very long, and eventually that never changed. And so by 1970, the Orthodox Church in America was born, and it became this autonomous group that would, operate all over, operate and kind of control all of the Orthodox communities here in America. And eventually they were recognized by later European communities, more specifically the Greek Orthodox Church, as being co-equal with them. But the Russian Orthodox Church still to this day does not recognize the OCA as legitimate. So again, you see these are steps by Greek Orthodox or Orthodox communities to declare we are Americans, we are on your side, and they took these dramatic steps against their churches. So as I said today, there's around 7 million, it's getting closer to 8 million Orthodox Christians here in America today. All right, so that was the Orthodox communities. The next group that we want to talk about is a new form of Protestantism that emerged within America, and that is Pentecostalism. So what is Pentecostalism? Pentecostalism emerged out of various healing and holiness movements within the 19th century. And so what do I mean by healing and holiness movements? So healing movements, we've already kind of talked about, was this idea that through the power of God, through the power of prayer, that one could physically heal themselves of many illnesses or diseases. And then the holiness movement was subsequently, and we'll talk about this here in a little bit later, but the holiness movement was this movement within the Methodist Church that following the doctrines of Arminianism, and we talked about this as well with John Knowles, John Humphrey Knowles and the Oneida community, that the holiness movement believed that one could perfect themselves now in this life and be fully Christians and fully have the penalty of sin removed from them from this life if they devoted themselves to extreme levels of personal piety, extreme levels of holiness. So it was this belief in the doctrine of regeneration, is what it's called. But it had influences later on that you, as humans, can become perfected. And we'll see why that's important because a lot of New Age religions and new religious movements that emerge, they emerge out of this holiness thinking. So although there's scattered incidences of Pentecostalism and Pentecostal style movements within church history, really, the genesis of the movement here in the United States and on the globe as well is always associated with the revivals at the famous Azusa Street Mission Church in Los Angeles in the early turn of the 20th century. So Pentecostalism is truly an American-made religion, but there are elements of Pentecostalism that emerged much, much earlier at various points. So, within the Catholic Church, there was very moments of Pentecostalism or spirituality or mysticalism that emerged, as well as in Protestantism as well. But Pentecostalism, like that of the Millerites that we talked about, and then later Seventh-day Adventists that Corrigan talks about in his textbooks, emerged as a restorationist group and emerged from among restorational views of history. And what I mean by that is that they believed that as a community, it was their job as Christians or as a community of believers to restore the practices advently. Restore the practices of the first church in order to reform the church. So get back to the first century, basically. We need to get back, we need to restore what the church used to be like. So this is what Pentecostalism is. This is what Seventh-day Adventism is. This is what Jehovah's Witnesses is. This is what Mormonism is, too. They all emerged out of this restoration movement to get the church back to what it used to be like because now it is corrupted. So Pentecostalism wanted to f a church that was free of the distractions and free of the corrupting baggage of church history. The church history has full of, bad history, of problematic doctrines, of persecution, of murder, of segregation, everything. And they wanted to free the church from all of these distractions. And thus they derived their ideas saying that, we need a church that was purely based on the New Testament alone, not upon these, the teachings of Martin Luther, not upon the teachings of John Calvin or church traditions or all these confessions like the Westminster Confession, the Philadelphia Confession, the New England Confession, all these things, church books, the Book of Common Prayer and Episcopalianism, the Methodist Book of Discipline that acts as a church governing body, that the church doesn't need that. There is no, we only need the New Testament alone. So their rallying cry was no church traditions, no church history, and no church doctrine. It was only going to be on the New Testament, on the New Testament alone. So for Pentecostalism, the vitality and the authority of both the church and Christianity doesn't rest on traditions, doesn't rest on history, doesn't rest on doctrines, but rests on the solely and completely on the events of Pentecost. That's an act that is described in Acts Gospels or the Book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, in which there was this great outpouring of the Holy Spirit on everybody. Flames of tongues appeared above the heads of individuals, and they began to speak each in their own language, and were able to understand each other, each in their own language. And so it was this dramatic event, but for Pentecostals, they believe that this moment represents the empowerment of the church and the church body, and that alone. So for Pentecostals, these experiences were intensified by their belief that the end of the world was coming and that the coming of Christ was intimate, that it was coming right now, tomorrow, if not 2 hours from now. And those who were not baptized in the Holy Ghost, who didn't have this kind of second baptism, as it's referred to in Pentecost, the second experience, that they would suffer during the tribulation, while those who were saved, who had received the second baptism were saved and will escape through the miracle of rapture. So you might believe in Christ and have a baptism, but you needed to have a secondary religious experience that they would call the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the Holy Ghost. So Pentecostals tend to look for this, promote this second blessing, this second baptism, through this very much emotional, religious emotional response that one must have in order to be saved and to know that you are saved. So, very briefly, a survey of Pentecostalism in America. Pentecostalism has its roots primarily in the teachings of Charles Fox Parham, who started a small Bible school in Topeka, Kansas, right at the turn of the 20th century, in 1900. Parham fully believed in divine healing, that someone could pray to God and some individual could have the powers to physically heal any ailment through the power of God. And he also taught that speaking in tongues, meaning speaking in some kind of alternative language, that you were filled with the Holy Ghost and that was a sign of you being filled with the Holy Ghost, that that was in fact scriptural. And that is evident of one receiving the second baptism. So you're speaking in this an unintelligible language, but everybody who has received the second baptism is able to understand this unintelligible language. And if you can't understand it, then you're not fully saved, and you need to have that secondary experience. And that secondary experience only comes through this kind of ecstatic relationship, this kind of charismatic relationship with God and with a church service. So famously on New Year's Day 1901, following a church service at his local Bible school there, Parham directed all the students to pray all night for the second baptism of the Holy Spirit. And then after they prayed hard and long and full and fervently, miraculously, sometime in the middle of the night, both Parham and the students were able to instantly start speaking in tongues and speaking and understanding each other. And a great revival event broke out in the school, then later in Topeka, Kansas, and then later in the region. And so after this event, Parham kind of became a full believer in this idea. And so he immediately closed the school and he began a 3-year revival tour across America. In order to promote this teaching, promote this idea, and to promote this type of experience and encourage it to happen. And he was further convinced of this experience because a similar experience was occurring completely separate from Parham in Wales in the UK in the 1904-1905, that a similar experience was happening and a similar revival was happening there in the UK. So Parham fully believed it even more so, and so went about spreading this new idea and this new teaching. Eventually, in 1905, Parham decided to settle down in Houston, Texas, and start another Bible college in order to train ministers to and how to cultivate this similar type of experience of having the second baptism. And so he was started to train ministers. Instead of him going out and teaching, he wanted to train ministers to go out and teach others. And one of his key students was a black man. Named William Seymour, who came to his school in Texas, was a firm believer, was an outstanding student. But later in 1906, Seymour left the college and went traveled to Los Angeles, California, in order to preach the same message. And he preached and he sparked a 3-year-long revival at the local church there that he was pastoring, which was the Azusa Street Mission Church that you see up here, right here. It became famously known in history, in LA history, as the Azusa Street Revivals. And the revivals were very much characterized by radical racial integration. You had blacks, you had whites, you had Mexicans, you had Asians, you had Native Americans all coming to these revivals in these churches at a time when segregation was the norm and was the practice policy. And what there appeared also to be at these revivals, that they were very loosely organized. There appeared to be an absence of any type of specific order. People would get up and speak. People were being moved by the Spirit. And so common people, normal people taking turns and being filled with the Holy Ghost to start preaching, or to, as we say, to start testifying, start witnessing about how the Spirit was moving. And so it was a remarkable thing. And it started to draw a lot of attention. This revival started to attract a lot of media attention, and various religious leaders across the United States started coming to Los Angeles and California to watch these revivals, and many of them were seeking to carry back the religious fire of this revival to their home churches. So that's why it lasted for 3 years and was extremely, extremely popular. And it captured the nation's attention for several years. But however, the revival garnered a lot of criticism by the media. And so this is from the LA Times during this period. In one of the front page articles that talks about that the front page title is A Weird Tongues of Babel. So that was a reference to the Tower of Babel story from Genesis chapter 11, in which the Bible records that man had the desire to go to had the desire to build a tower to come together and build this massive tower to God in order to seek God back out again and to live and experience heaven once again, because man had been thrown out of the garden and had suffered the bad the traumatic event of the flood. And so this was a secondary attempt for man to retake Eden in such a way. And so the Bible story goes that because of man's arrogance, God had to come down to Babel and had to split the people, because they were becoming too powerful. They were coming together, and thus, according to the Bible, this is the birth of different languages. That God, in order to break everybody up, he forced everybody overnight to start speaking another language. And so no one could communicate together. Nobody can build anything together because they don't understand each other. And soon differences and problems emerge, and thus man is splitted forever. And so avoiding his way to become like God or storm his way back to heaven. So the story is referring back to that this was an alt, a way for men to, merge back together out of craziness, but this seems to be unnatural and needs to be broken up. But also too, there's a play of tongue there in the Bible, because the term Babel in Hebrew is the same word we have in English. A babbling idiot is what it referring to. Somebody that just goes blah, 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 blah. That's what it's referring to. And so it's making fun of that as well. Weird tongues of Babel. People are babbling. So if you read the front page report, it goes on to report that the congregants there, that you could hear strange utterances being made, mouthing a creed that no sane mortal could understand, disgraceful intermingling of the races, howling noises all day and all night, running, jumping, shaking all over, shouting at the tops of their lungs, spinning around in circles, falling on the floor, kicking and rolling all over it. These people appear to be mad. And that was the characterizations of these revivals, and it also becomes the characterizations later on of Pentecostals. If you ever go to a Pentecostal church, I've been to several, or Assembly of God church, that's what you see. That's what you experience. A lot of running around, shaking, a lot of shouting, a lot of screaming, a lot of hollering, a lot of weird noises. Everybody just appears to be mad. And so thus, the attendants became known, whoever went to the revivals, they became known as holy rollers, because they were often caught rolling around the ground, rolling in their pews. Holy roller. So it became a very negative term to refer to Pentecostals. But now, it's still a negative term for those that are kind of holier than thou type attitude people, or people that, are very charismatic in worship. But also, a lot of the Christian ministers and leaders of the day who came and saw what was going on were also very critical of the movement and of the revivals, and they saw that as being over emotional, misusing scripture, and having lost focus on the message of Christ. So this became kind of the attitude of Pentecostalism. And so as the movement spread, Pentecostals kind of very early on, and still somewhat to this day, represent an outsider to normal forms of Protestantism in America. And it's because of that, it's something, it is different, very emotional, and is often mischaracterized or seen as something other. But even though that is still a dominant form of Protestantism today in America and across the globe, within the Protestant community or within the Christian community. Most Christians, Protestant leaders and Catholic leaders look down upon Pentecostalism or any elements of Pentecostalism as being something unholy or unworthy. But despite all of that, despite of all this criticism of all of the bad media press, the Pentecostal movement was unstoppable. It was able to survive and was able to spread like a wildfire. And subsequently, really, since the 1970s, Pentecostalism became legitimate. It became a legitimate form of Protestantism and as a denomination. And what made Pentecostalism so appealing and it was able to spread and survive and continues to spread and survive to this day is because Pentecostalism is able to really defy social and cultural norms of its time. And more specifically, and still to this day, racial segregation. Pentecostal churches typically are highly integrated, racially integrated communities. Most of them are, and still to this day, if you ever go to a Pentecostal church, there's whites, there's blacks, there's Chinese, there's Mexicans, there's everybody there. And it's a rarity among Protestantism. And so this is what made it so successful, that it was able to reach the divide that the Catholic Church or the Protestant Church was unable or unwilling to do, and that the Protestant and Catholic Church still struggles with today over race integration. But the Pentecostal Church was able to overcome that quite easily because of their focuses and because of their messages and because of the experience. But however, over time, Pentecostal churches also suffered the same fate. There is some racial segregation, particularly here in the South, like everywhere else. So even though on a larger scale Pentecostalism had broke the mold, on a smaller scale there is some racial segregation, because it's primarily because these churches reside in the South where racial tensions are still hot and still messy, and the church still hasn't or is unwilling to deal with it here in the American South. But on a global scale, which is surprising, it's a religious movement that's just a little over 100 years old. Pentecostalism, by really 1990, became the largest denomination of Protestantism in the world. So, an American denomination, this is the growth and the strength of this denomination. That American movement now, it represents the largest, over 280 million people around the world self-identify themselves with Pentecostalism. That they're about the second highest Protestant denomination in the world behind Pentecostalism is Anglicanism because of the empire, the old British Empire. So you can see the power of Pentecostalism and the power of their movement, and that the movement is able to survive and spread because of its claims and because of its encouragement of having a religious experience. And so thus Pentecostalism was able to grow here in America. So very excuse me, very briefly, I want to talk about divine healing within Pentecostalism, because that became a dominant feature. And it would eventually emerge and transform itself with TV evangelism as well. So healing has been a central importance to the Pentecostal movement. Belief that through power of prayer, that an individual can be, by laying upon of hands, that someone can be healed of a physical element. And since its beginning within Pentecostalism, it's always played an important role. However, this particular focus is not surprising, given that the movement emerged at a time in America where America was generally interested in aspects of divine healing. We had Scientology, not Scientology, but Christian Science movement that was emerging just 30 years before the Pentecostal movement. You had a lot of emergence of self-help books and self-therapy books, or the emergence of philosophical psychological ideas and training and therapy sessions of self-healing and self-realization. So it's not surprising. And we've already discussed its influence, as I said, within the Christian Science movement. But probably one of the best known of the Pentecostal healers was the famous Canadian American Amy Semple McPherson. She was very much known for having a magnetic personality, very beautiful, glamorous. She liked to wear fancy dresses, wear modern looking clothings, and was very attractive. And she had several husbands, several suitors. And was very much had a flair for the dramatics. And so there's most famously she as a traveling minister and traveling preacher, she actually survived an airplane crash in 1922, I think it was, or 1921. She survived an airplane crash, the only survivor. And she as quickly as she could, she with hospital bandages and everything on, she went to a church and preached her message while she's wearing a hospital gown, wearing a cast and everything, and talking about the power of belief in God, that on the airplane crash she was the only one that was praying, and that because she was the only one that was praying, everyone else died on the airplane crash except her. So this is the power of prayer, and this is the power that God has in your life. Also, another time she famously rode a motorcycle inside the church and on top of the stage, rode it around the individuals and the people, and dressed up like a police cop. And she gave a sermon talking about God being the police officer in the community, and that he's writing tickets. And this is what the Bible is, and stuff like that. She was very much flair for the dramatics. She had large choirs, large orchestras at her church. You can see here, she built the famous. Her famous Angelus Temple in Los Angeles that had 5,000 seat auditorium. And so there she is at right here. This is Amy McPherson in one of her church services. And so she's preaching a sermon surrounded by all these choir singers. And look how amazing the church looks and all the choreographic everything. And she's wearing this dramatic robe with a big red cross on her chest while she's preaching these sermons. And she was just fanatical and just tenacious with their sermons. Like I said, in preaching 22 sermons a week. She had a radio station, she was an author, publication. She was very much in your face with her denominations. But the reason she was able to draw a crowd was that she claimed to have healing powers. And so this was the big draw that she had. And so the story goes is that at first she was a traveling evangelist, and she was wildly unknown at the time. And so she was preaching a sermon in New York at Madison Square Garden, and hardly nobody was attending in 1915. And but however, during the ceremony service, it was reported that a young woman who was crippled. Allie McPherson brought her up to the stage and miraculously healed her. Yes, so not 1915, but 1916, sorry. Miraculously healed her of severe cases of rheumatoid arthritis, but so much where she couldn't walk. But however, she was miraculously healed and instantly was able to walk off stage. And so that actually started, and so the very next day, a lot of people came because they wanted to see this incident and hear this story of how she was able to heal this person. So it became a routine part of her services and revivals to have have healing ceremonies, and that it would become a standard pattern for really all Pentecostal services going forward, particularly the large revival services that Pentecostals do. So, it's believed that many of these cases were all faked and all staged, but no one really knows for certain because, Allie McPherson, she died quite young in some sense before people became very skeptical of her beliefs. But again, it was kind of saw that she was that these healing services were largely fake, and they've then later been proven to be fake. But then there are some elements that seem to be real and authentic, so it's always this weird part, so you never know. But here, I want to show you a very quick presentation about Amy Sipple McPherson and kind of hear her voice, because she really capitalized on new media very early on.
You're drifting away from the faith of your fathers. You're drifting away from prayer, drifting away from the Bible reading, drifting away from the family altar, and only ruin and the heartbreak and the home break lay in the direction of backsliding. I am coming out to help bring you back, if I can, to the fold. Give me a burden for souls, Lord. Give me a love for the lost. Let my heart bleed as thine own, Lord. Give me a burden for souls.
On New Year's Day, 1923, Angelus Temple, the largest church in the city, opened its doors to the public for the first time. McPherson had managed to raise $300,000 for the grand building, leading one critic to say that Sister Amy had put the cost in Pentecost.
Along about 3 o'clock on Sunday, there would be a line of people down Glendale Boulevard for two blocks. And at 5 o'clock, the doors would open and 5,000 people would course into this building and fill every seat.
McPherson had built one of the first mega churches in the United States, and she designed it to look more like a place for Hollywood movies than a place of worship.
And in comes Mrs. McPherson with a huge bouquet of roses. And the moment the crowd sees her, 5,000 people start applauding wildly.
Friends, let's give our lives to Jesus Christ. Let's really become healed in Jesus.
Once on the Angelus Temple stage, Sister Amy used her unique blend of humor, charisma, and storytelling to deliver the age-old evangelical message about salvation through Jesus Christ. Each service built to the same climax, the altar call, or the invitation to come forward and be born again.
Everyone stand it, as I need Jesus in my life.
Quite often, people that come down, their lives are changed from that very night, and they become a Christian.
Come on, young man, come on down from that balcony.
She published monthly magazines. And just at the moment when radio was born, she built her own Christian radio station. KFSG broadcast Angelus Temple sermons, healing services instructing listeners to place their hands on their radio sets, and serial dramas such as The Adventures of Jim Trask, Lone Evangelist. Some nights, the signal reached as far as Australia.
When she first envisioned the station, she said that there were some 200,000 radio receiving sets in the Los Angeles area. But within just a few years, radio was ubiquitous in nearly every home, and she had the foresight to ride the crest of that wave.
My friends, if you're starving, tonight there's salvation. There's a baptism of the Holy Ghost.
Shortly before she died, Sister Amy applied for a license for an experimental television station. And so had she lived, she surely would have been one of the first televangelists.
Sorry, let me go back. All right, so you can see a little bit about Amy McPherson. And really what she kind of starts to, and we'll get to it with the later new religious movements among the African-American community, she starts to kind of cultivate and create a cult of personality. And what we mean by that is a lot of people were drawn to Amy McPherson's message and her church, not because of the message, but because of her. And so people were drawn to Christianity or drawn to her form of Christianity, not because of Jesus or faith, but really because of her and the sight show that she was. And that would become a standard bearer among many other great, later mega churches or, revival services or divine healers. And typically people go to these churches not because of the services, but because of the personality of the leader. So you develop this kind of cult-like following that we'll later see is problematic when we get to Jim Jones, when we later get to Heaven's Gates, new religious movements. So now I want to talk about and transition to the emergence of a few other new religious movements at this time that grew large. And so the first being that of the Jehovah's Witness. So many of the new religious movements like Pentecostalism, like Christian Sciences, or Mormonism emerged because of a great dissatisfaction among the current streams of American Christianity. And many of them turned to either restorational groups for returns or for experiences, but others turned to millennial groups for immediate hope and rescue because of their situation, or that the world around them seemed so dire, and that these millennial groups were claiming that Christ was coming back any day now, so if you believe and you're a part of this group, you will be saved. So it was this kind of rescue effort. And so one of the most popular within the American groups of this millennial group, besides things like the Seventh-day Adventist Church, was the Jehovah's Witness group. And so we need to talk a little bit about their history and their formation here. So the movement was founded by Charles Taze Russell, who was a charismatic preacher, but he became a charismatic preacher. But he was more of a writer and editor than a preacher. But he was very much influenced by the Adventist movement that sprung up out of the disappointments and the failures of the Millerite community that we talked about. So the story goes that in 1876, that Russell started to receive these millennialist mailers. And so what these were these little mailed out tracts that would come to your home that you would read, and they would have stories, they'll have Bible verses, they would have this essay about why, the world is coming to an end. Here's a report of all the signs. I've done the math. I've read this Bible. I've talked to God, and this is what's going to happen. And he was very deeply convicted by his teachings, and particularly by one specific author of many of these millennialist mailers, that being Nelson Barber, who believed that Christ was coming, his intimate return was coming very soon. And so the story goes is that Russell was at the time a very successful businessman. And he firmly believed in what Russell Barber was doing. He firmly believed that the world was coming to an end very shortly. And so, in turn, he sold his 5 clothing stores that he owned in the greater Pittsburgh area for around $300,000, which I think was equivalent to today's money, around $2 million, maybe $3 million. In order to bankroll Barber's revivals. And he actually wrote a letter to Nelson Barber when Barber was preaching at a service in Philadelphia, and the two men met, and Nelson agreed to have Russell come along and help him in his businesses. And so Russell began to write many of the little mailer tracts for Barber. And so he began to publish many of the warnings and the second comings of Christ, immediate return, particularly in the year 1878. So when 1878 arrived, and they had a significant amount of followers because of Russell's writing ability and because of Barber's preaching techniques, they had a massive amount of followers. But however, when 1878 arrived and the expected rapture didn't occur, Russell sought to reevaluate what he believed in, particularly what he believed about Christianity. And his solution was, the reason why Christ wasn't coming back is because Christianity, the current forms of Christianity, were to blame. the infighting that was in the church, the fighting over doctrinal issues, the fighting over fundamentalism and stuff like that, liberal elements, that these were all the problems with Christianity. And that the problem why Christ couldn't return is because it lied within the church and lied within Christianity, and Christianity was corrupted and wrong. And so what he did was he advocated for a hybrid version of restorationism, but restorationism according to his beliefs, not so much the first church, but his beliefs and interpretations about what he read from the Bible. And so eventually Russell took his ideas and took many of his, you know, his teachings and his interpretations of the Bible, and he took them back to Barber and told them about what he believed in, and that believed that the problem lied within Christianity, within Christian doctrines, etc. However, Barber and Nelson reportedly had a public falling out subsequently after that. Barber thought he was crazy, and they broke away. And so in turn, Russell removed all of his investments, money, and then thus established his own publication service, which would be known as Zion's Watchtower. And so that would subsequently become known simply as the Watchtower. And if anybody received any kind of publication from a Jehovah's Witness, you know that this is always the book that they hand out to you. It's a magazine series or publication series known as the Watchtower. And later he would establish what is known as the Zion's Watchtower Tract Society. So it wasn't so much a religious group, but it would later become a religious group. But they were fanatical about writing and passing out tracts to the community. And so it was kind of this religious community that in turn became not so much a religious community as it became like lifesavers or watch guard or lifesaver guards out on the beach. Lifeguards is what I was meaning. And so where they were just warning people and passing out tracts and mailing out tracts and speaking to people, inviting people to come and listen to Russell speak, or recording on vinyl records became popular. Many people would actually pass out Russell's vinyl recordings out to people. And so it became this kind of tract society and less so a religious group, but it eventually evolves into being a religious group. So to disseminate his message, Russell began cultivating a following, a religious following, and creating what he would refer to as Bible students, who believed that the Christian religion and traditions had been corrupted and that they were corrupting God's true message, and that it was their job to go out and educate people and convince people of the error of their traditional beliefs and ways, and that their work was to restore God's original message and to restore it from the great apostasy, as they refer to it, of modern elements of faith. So modern forms of Protestantism, Catholicism, Judaism, that those are the great apostasies from God, and what that Russell had and what his followers had was in fact the true belief of Christ. Russell believed, and you read from much of his tracts what you gather, and his community believed as well, Russell believed that there would be a heavenly resurrection of only 144,000 people, and that was according to a passage in the book of Revelation in which John saw a great host of people who were being taken up to heaven, and he asked him how many, and there was the 144,000 people. And so he took that to be quite literal, that only 144,000 people will actually become saved, and that's it. He did not believe in hell because Jesus really never spoke of hell. The New Testament doesn't speak of hell a lot until you get to the book of Revelation. So he believed that rather what hell was that people would simply sleep for eternity, and that's what hell was. It wasn't this place of fire and damnation as later Dante's Inferno takes the image of hell and we make it canonical and make it gospel. But the New Testament didn't really paint the images of hell in that context. He didn't believe in the Trinity, and he believed that Christ only became divine after he made his great sacrifice on the cross, and so that Christ was originally a man, was born a man, but then only became divine after he gave his life as a sacrifice for all. And so this is the popular Christian belief known as adoptionism. That was held by many early Christians early on in the early centuries, but then later was declared a heresy by the Catholic Church. And he believed that Christ had, and then he also believed that Christ actually had already returned, but he had returned in a spiritual form instead of a physical form. And that the world's last day was in fact going to be 1914, and that he had already returned to him and his community in order to empower them and to give the community the correct message, and that they would have a short period of time to go about saving everybody before the world would become an end. He was also, what would you think about 1914? What, on a world stage, what happened in 1914, which actually served to create a lot of people started to become Jehovah's Witnesses around this time. What happened in 1914? The start of World War One. And so many people saw Russell's prophecy that he's making this back in 1878. He's making this prophecy that there's going to be a great apocalyptic war that's going to consume every nation, and every nation is going to fight each other. Then at the end of this war, Christ will eventually return. What happens in 1914? The start of World War One. So a lot of people recall and say, oh, maybe Russell was right. Maybe the Jehovah's Witnesses were right. So a lot of people became and converted to this new religious group during this time. But Russell was also, surprisingly, one of the first that we know of, first advocate for climate change or climate alarmist. He believed that the weather was constantly changing, that the polar ice caps were melting, and that these were all signs of Christ returning, and that, and so he was very much one of the first climate activists out there in the world in his publications. Eventually, following his death in 1916, the leadership of the community of the Tract Society was in jeopardy, because he didn't have a son. Russell and the community, so the society met together and they actually decided to elect and appoint somebody as a successor, and they appointed Joseph Franklin Rutherford, who was actually Russell's personal attorney as well as the attorney for the society as a large. Russell was very successful in changing the society away from being that of a personality cult that followed Russell and Russell's teaching, to actually making the Jehovah's Witness community more and more a active religious denomination, with a church hierarchy and church structures, church buildings, regular worship services, and acting more and more like a denomination instead of this kind of, again, tract society or personality cult. And it was Rutherford who advocated for the change of name away from the Zion Watchtower, you know, Bible Tract Society, to change the name to Jehovah's Witness, based on a passage from Isaiah chapter 43, where it says, "You are my witness, declares Jehovah. Yes, my servant in whom I have chosen." And he started the practice, Rutherford started the practice of house-to-house witnessing or door-to-door meeting, where, you know, your local, get a local visit from your local Jehovah's Witness, come knocking on the door. It wasn't the Mormons that did it, but the Mormons copied the Jehovah's Witness. And so it's what the practice that Jehovah's Witness became famous for their conversion. However, it was also under Rutherford's leadership that the group experienced its most amounts of level of persecution. And persecution due to Rutherford's beliefs and the beliefs that trickled down to the community as well. During World War One, it was Rutherford's belief, and Rutherford taught and published strong criticism that the Catholic Church and the Protestant Church and its clergy were all equally complicit in the causes and the atrocities of World War One. They should be judged as war criminals, because Rutherford taught that Christianity and what Jesus taught based off a passage of Matthew's Gospel 26, where Jesus says, "Those who live by the sword shall die by the sword," that this is what Christians are called to be, pacifists, not to participate in war. So Jehovah's Witness today, all Jehovah's Witnesses are pacifists. They do not take part in war, and they are exempt based off their religious beliefs from serving in the military. Or if they do serve in the military, which they don't, but if they ever did, the United States government could only, by protecting their religious rights, allow them to serve in acts of medical treatment or supply. Or, well, not even supply, because that would be still be, but I think medical treatment. But I wanted to show you a little video, because this is some of the language that was being done at the time. And so this is a video clip from a famous French movie, Jouit Noël, but they reframe it as being children taught in schools, but actually the passage that the children are reading from are taken from sermons instead. So this is why I wanted to show it, because this was what was going on, and Rutherford was quite right. So listen to what these children are saying. Read the subtitles, because a French child speaks, a German child speaks, and then an English child speaks. Or it's, no, it's French, English, then German. But there are actually excerpts from sermons instead of being done in a classroom, that how the movie presents it. So I wanted to show you this.
Enfant, regarde sur ces cartes ce point noir qu'il faut effacer. De tes petits doigts, tu l'écartes. En rouge, il vaut mieux le tracer. Plus tard, quoi que le sort te fasse, promets-moi bien d'aller là-bas, chercher les enfants de l'Alsace qui nous tendent leurs petits bras. Puisse, en notre chère France, les rameaux verts de l'espérance fleurir par toi, mon cher enfant. Grandis. La France attend.
To rid the map of every trace of Germany and of the Hun, we must exterminate that race. We must not leave a single one. Heed not their children's cries. Their slayer now, the woman too, or else someday again they'll rise, which if they're dead, they cannot do.
Ein Feind ist unserer und einer allein. Schon meißelt er Deutschlands Grabestein voller Hass. Ist sein Busen voller Neid und voll Pein. Ein Feind ist unserer und einer allein. Nun hebt der Freveler die Meuchelnde an. Sein Name, du kennst ihn, ist England.
So that was kind of the attitude during the period of World War I. It was correct that a lot of it was being promulgated. A lot of ministers and churches and church leaders were calling for arms and calling for people and for average people to take up arms, protect their country, but then to kill the Germans as well. And this was your call of duty. And so Rutherford was responding to this correctly and saying this isn't the place for the church. The church should not be actively promulgating these kinds of sentiments and ideologies. But however, because of that, here in the United States in 1918, President Woodrow Wilson ordered the arrest of thousands of people who were Jehovah's Witnesses, and their leaders were imprisoned and were charged under the Espionage Act of being treasonous and being traitors to the country. So during World War I, and then also later on in World War II, Jehovah's Witnesses suffered a lot of persecution because they were accused of being traitors because they would not support the war effort. And so Rutherford also taught that saluting a national flag, like saying the Pledge of the Allegiance, is a form of idolatry, and nor should any member participate in the draft, or no man can, because he would cite often Jesus' passage that no man can serve two masters. You will either love one or hate the other. So you can't serve your nation. You can only serve God. So again, during World War I especially, but also in World War II, there was a significant amount of periods of mob violence being done on Jehovah's Witnesses because of their refusal to support the war effort and being very outspoken. Particularly Rutherford was very outspoken about the war. And again, Jehovah's Witnesses refusing to pledge the allegiance to the American flag. And so this is why Jehovah's Witnesses, kind of, again, like Pentecostals to some extent, remain on the periphery of American society, but more so for the Jehovah's Witnesses because of this, because of these teachings by Rutherford, to not salute the flag, to not be a part of American society, to not support America when it goes to war, and that Christians, the call for Christians to be pacifist. And in the history of the Jehovah's Witness community, they were persecuted, particularly more harshly by Woodrow Wilson and during World War I than World War II. However, when Rutherford died in 1942, the Jehovah's Witness community started to transition its leadership again, away from a hierarchical structure where, you know, Rutherford became the president, and thus kind of some of his ideas and ideologies and teachings trickled down to the communities as well. The leadership changed to that of a collective, as a board of directors versus an individual, and it focused more on having a global footprint as well as having a footprint, a significant footprint here in America. So in 1942, when Rutherford died, the group, Jehovah's Witnesses, had churches in the United States, in Canada, and in Germany. So you might have saw that picture from the beginning of a badge that Jehovah's Witnesses had to wear in the German prisons. There were about over 1,000, I think, maybe 5,000, but I think it's less than 5,000 confirmed Jehovah's Witnesses who were captured by the German Nazi groups and who were sent to death camps along with Jews as well. So there were several Jehovah's Witnesses who were persecuted in Nazi Germany as well during World War II. But you can see from 1942, it had a small footprint in the United States and Canada and Germany. But by 1960, that the membership had grown to over 1 million followers. So Jehovah's Witnesses typically now don't interpret the 144,000 to be so literal and have it as a more allegorical reading. And then by later, 15 years later, the movement had grown to 2 million in 15 years. And so you have, by today, the Jehovah's Witness has a membership. They don't call it, converts or fellowship or whatever. You're part of a membership. But has memberships. They don't say themselves as believers, but memberships of around 9 million people. And they meet annually and report annually. And Jehovah's Witness is one of the few religions, like Catholicism, I would say, that could you speak of this, that Jehovah's Witness truly, truly has a global presence. You can go read their annual reports that the Jehovah's Witness gives every year, and literally they have a person, a Jehovah's Witness member, in every single country from A to Z. Like, I didn't even know some countries existed or territories existed until I read the Jehovah's Witness, you know, annual reports. So they have people everywhere across the globe. And so it is truly now a global religion. So the last thing that I want to talk about before we conclude today is new religious movements among African-American communities. Because typically we've been talking about new religious movements that have emerged within white America. And oftentimes, and even Corrigan doesn't do justice, a lot of books don't give justice to this, that African-Americans had significant amounts of new religious movements that emerged within their own community. And so very briefly, I just want to talk about two. We'll also talk about another being the Nation of Islam in our next lecture. But these are two popular ones that had very strong personality cults with their following. But they also helped to shape later new religious movements, as well as Pentecostal or Protestantism as well. So like white disaffected Protestants, many within the African-American community were also developing their own new religious movements among dissatisfied black Protestant people as well. And so one of the most famous ones early on was that established by Charles Manuel Grace and the United House of Prayer for All People. So I think there's not a United House of Prayer here in Panama City, but there is one in Tallahassee. So they are around, but they're becoming more and more rare, but they are around, and they're very similar to Protestantism, Almost 90% identify as Protestantism, but they have some small similarities. But the leader of the group was Charles Manuel Grace, who was actually a Portuguese African who came to Boston area, but then converted to Catholic. Oh, he was converted from Catholicism to Methodism, he was enthralled by the Wesleyan holiness movement. And particularly the doctrine of regeneration, believing that human beings can perfect themselves within this lifetime through extreme levels of personal piety, personal holiness, as well as he believed firmly in the divine healing. So he was always influential and in amazed by churches and wanted to be a minister, but was never accepted in Boston because of him being a black man. And was often never allowed to preach. And so starting in 1919, he saved up enough money as a chef cook on a railroad track that was going from Boston to New York City. And he was the cook along this on this railroad for a commuter train. And he saved up enough money, and then he started to preach his messages and healing people, and even healing people of their illnesses. And most famously in 1919 in Boston, he claimed that he was able to raise a young girl from the dead whose name Eugenia. And Eugenia would often accompany Charles Grace on many of his speaking tours, and she would give testimonies of what it was like dying and living on the other side and having visions of the white light and going to the white light and then hearing Charles Grace's voice calling to her and meeting her in this transit plane and guiding her back to life and describing all these things. And so it drew a large crowd of people. And he tried, again, he was not accepted within the holiness movement, which is dominantly white oriented. And so he kind of created his own version of Pentecostalism to an extent, the United House of Prayer, but it eventually would fade away over time because Pentecostalism was able to emerge as a legitimate denomination where a lot of intersegregation was occurring. But however, Charles Grace, while he's more popular and sometimes known as Sweet Daddy Grace, is because how he funded his preaching tours, and that he was very innovative in his ability in creating merchandise, merchandising and campaigning, and going to revivals, and you would buy materials, you would buy clothing, you would buy special products from him in order to support his campaign. But then later on, many of these products became infused with Christian elements, so you could buy these special kind of soaps that would have healing properties, or you can buy special herbal teas and coffees that had healing properties from him that he had prayed over, that or he had researched and discovered, or that you can buy his magazines that had articles in them about how to improve your health, improve your relationship, but perfect yourself and being and humanly perfection. And so he kind of created the trend that we would later see of TV evangelists doing, and this is why he's so popular, of creating merchandise and products that people would buy from them out of fear. So if you go look at somebody like Jimmy Swagger on YouTube, that he will have you buy special products from him, prayer cloths, prayer oils, stuff like that. This is where it kind of really got started, was with Sweet Daddy Grace and how he publicly funded his revival campaigns as well as his lavish lifestyle. But he set the trend as well, because he often believed that ministers should dress to perfection as well. So that you can see this image of him, that he was always stylish, he was always looking his best, and he believed that ministers of the gospel should mirror this type of image to their community as well. So he kind of created that trend of as well within a lot of black preachers of wearing flamboyant clothing or flamboyant styles as well in order to create this type of image. So that was Charles Daddy Grace. But probably the more significant leader was, he's known as Father Divine, but we really don't know his real name. We don't know much about his beginnings because he never talked about it, never talked about when he was born. He really didn't know because he was an orphan and raised in foster homes, but he never gave his real name. But he becomes known later on in history, in American history, as Father Divine. But he also goes by his legal name that he made for himself. Reverend Major Jealousy Divine was his real name. But he was very much influenced by the New Thought movement. The New Thought movement, if you're not familiar with it, I think Corrigan talks about it in your textbook. But it was this idea that we already mentioned with the Christian Science movement that one could heal themselves with positive thinking and positive thoughts and the power of positive thinking. And so he was very a strong believer of that and tried to apply it to the Christian message and the Christian gospel. And so all we know is that around 1907, the person of Father Divine emerges on the scene in rural Maryland, traveling around to town, preaching his style of message. And so we know these reports about him because he gained a lot of controversy, and particularly similar to what Sweet Daddy Grace believed in as well, of the doctrine of regeneration, that one could perfect himself in this life. Father Divine believed that as well, so much so that he believed that he had perfected himself in this life now, that he became the embodiment of God here on earth. And so he famously, outside of Maryland, I think in Townsend, Maryland, he claimed that I am the Eternal Father. Everybody viewed that as he was claiming himself to be God. And he preached that there is no gender, that so therefore there is no gender roles, gender inclusivity within being a Christian, and that everybody was called to live a life of celibacy. So as you can imagine, Father Divine didn't get a lot of popularity. He was run out of every town that he visited in Maryland. So subsequently, he appears later on in Georgia, preaching his same message, where we find him in 1913 being imprisoned there for being accused of inciting a riots because of his message and teaching that, you know, the power of positive thinking and empowerment of everybody, including black Americans in the Jim Crow South. But eventually he finds success once in Valdosta, Georgia, in 1914. He establishes a small community of African Americans who believe in his message and believe that he is God incarnate here on this earth. But eventually the townspeople of Valdosta chased him and his community away, and he was forced to escape to New York in 1919. And that's when we know he changed his name, and he's known as Father Divine, or Major Jealous, because God was majorously a jealous God. So thus, why he referred to himself that way. But it was while in New York that Father Divine transitions much of his movement, and he becomes this de facto civil rights leader and starts gaining followers among dissatisfied German Americans in Brooklyn and Queens, New York, and he starts to develop and encourage the development of integrated neighborhoods in New York and on Long Island. And through a series of kind of money-making schemes that he had, he would use a lot of his money-making schemes in order to lift young black kids out of poverty. And so these weren't negative schemes. He believed that in order to lift black kids out of poverty, and black kids or black young men out of social injustices, that they needed jobs. And so thus he would get a lot of people to support him and his investments, and thus in turn he would build black only community-run businesses. So a lot of laundromats, like he actually started a lot of the self-coined laundromats, and this is how he gained a lot of his funding. But he would only hire young black kids to run his communities. He also bought hotels, old hotels or old apartments, and converted them into apartments, but apartments for his community and people who followed his ideas. And that's where he began his international peace mission movement within his church. Eventually, in 1931, he was arrested by the state of New York for holding one of his famous interracial banquets. And so this is what he started doing, is he would host these big, huge banquets and shared meals, and it became part of a religious service that his community would do, where whites and blacks would come together. And he believed that only if whites and blacks would come together and share a meal, that is when the true elements of Christianity or religion would actually emerge. And so famously, he had one of his famous interracial banquets where over 3,000 people came and attended his banquet out in Long Island, New York, and it gained national attention. And then, two, he gained further attention when he was in being tried in court publicly, and that, according to reports from the New York Times, that during his trial service, and that the judge was, going through this long soliloquy about why, he was a famous racist judge, and the judge was giving his speech, that one of the court reporters noticed that Father Divine was sitting there with his eyes closed, and he's mouthing something in silence the entire time, and no one knows what he said until afterwards. And what came to be found out was that Father Divine said that during the time he was praying the entire time to God, that or to yeah to God, that the judge would die. And actually, it happened. Later that day, that evening, the judge suffered a massive heart attack and died. And so Father Divine became this, famous overnight character because he had divine powers, that he could not only heal people, that he claimed, but he could also kill people. And there was evidence of that he killed this judge by simply praying. But however, instead of capitalizing on that, he became a, like I said, a de facto civil rights leader. And he created this kind of cult following around him, his community, known as the International Peace Mission, where they would travel around the world, where he would go on these speaking engagements, perform these healing services, perform these racial banquets services, and teach the power of positive thinking. And so Time Magazine reported that because of his popularity in 1934, that he had over 2 million followers across the globe. We don't know if that's true or not, but he was a very popular leader. But he became a civil rights leader, and he used religion, started to use religion in order to advocate for social change. And so he would later become a, he would set up a paradigm that Martin Luther King would follow. But he would also, because of his personality and claiming that he was divine and that he was God incarnate, a lot of other later new religious movements like Jim Jones and the People's Temple, would follow his idea. Jim Jones followed Father Divine's pattern, actually talked to him, was a mentor to Jim Jones, and followed his leading. So I wanted to give you those two guys very briefly. There's not much known about these guys because, again, like Charles Grace, much of his, new religious movement was very much Protestant oriented, but it just was never accepted by the Protestant church on a large scale. But some of his techniques would later influence other Protestant communities or Pentecostal leaders as well. And like Father Divine, he claimed divine status for himself, claimed that he was God incarnate, and we'll see that same pattern repeat itself with the person of Jim Jones.